This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer.
Hello, Jennifer.
Hi, Richard.
How are you?
I am fabulous.
You are a symphony in green today. For those driving in their car, I'm looking at Jennifer on our podcast.
You're very sweet. I actually want to talk about what happened after the podcast, because I didn't mention during the podcast what I was dealing with last week.
Oh, tell us, please.
Last week, I lost my dad's ring. But
oh, my gosh, that ring.
I lost it from, we were in downtown Manhattan Beach two nights before New Year's. Yeah, it was Friday night. And I always have it. It flew off my hand. When I got in the car, I realized it was gone. And I just, we had a search team. Everybody was looking. There was only two places it could have been, or it was on the street somewhere. I went home, searched our car, cleared it, cleaned it out. I went home just devastated. The next morning, I meditate. I'm like, what is that about my, you know, starting my new year? And this ring was my grandfather's, that was given to my dad, that was given to me when he passed. You know, for the last 6 years, I've been wearing it, you know, and my dad kept on telling me I'm in your heart. I'm in your heart. And every sign was 71, because that's my sign with my dad, or yeah, butterflies. And I had some very interesting things happen after the podcast. My girlfriend Colby, who's a great medium, Colby Rubble, she texted, she goes, I don't know why. She goes, you know, I'm not like this, but I'm just letting you know your dad's thinking of you. And I just feel like I need to say that. And then I had another girlfriend, Chris Macker, who, dear friend of mine, she's like, I don't know why, but these pictures of your dad keep showing up on my phone from 6 years ago.
Wow.
And she goes, and that's before we were even, she goes, I just need to share that with you. And I, you know, I started crying. I didn't even want to explain to them. I didn't even explain on the podcast how heartbroken I was over this.
Wow.
And then I get in the car after the podcast and I put my briefcase in the back. I noticed that the seat's down because we took the Christmas tree back. Well, the seat was in my car, whatever. Seat was down. So I pushed it back and I saw something shining over there. And I mean, we scoured our car. I went over there and I just started bawling. This was right after our podcast. I just started bawling. And I'm like, Dad. And I didn't know. I'm like, and I would meditate every morning. Just, I didn't care when it came back to me. I just felt it coming back on my finger. I now wear it on a different finger because this one's, it just flies off now. So wear it on a different finger. But he gave me so much love during this process and showed me so many signs, but it just made me even more heartbroken. You know, the more signs that he gave me, I'm like, how am I going to tell my family? The only thing that it was my connection to him. And it was very interesting, you know, whether it's part of the meditation that I was doing in the morning or whether it's part of just the fact that it was, you know, maybe it was, I flew it in the back of the car and when they put the Christmas tree in and then, I mean, the fact that I don't know and I don't care, but I was so overjoyed getting it back.
Well, I love when your dad shows up in our podcast and he shows up in our conversation sometimes. And what's fun about him is that he is so present and able to answer questions. So why don't we ask Jim, what happened? Was it just a goofy coincidence or was it designed for her to be able to talk about this?
Oh, that's interesting. He goes, she never lost it. You can't lose the energy of something, he says. That's interesting. He was trying to tell me, that he was in my heart, that it's not a physical thing, that he's in my heart. And he's laughing. He does this every once in a while when he makes a joke. He's like, it was a mason ring. Maybe you shouldn't be wearing it. Like joking around about it. He's like, maybe it's cursed. Who knows? He goes, if you believe in those kind of things. He's like, no. He knew how important it was. He couldn't. I was too flustered that I couldn't even ask him where it was that night. He showed me how my brain was just broken. Yeah. Overwhelmed, just broken. And so I lost a diamond bracelet 2 weeks prior. And then I'm like, well, I got the ring back. So that morning I meditated. I got a little pop in my head and I knew it was in the house somewhere, but it was gone for 2 weeks. And I found it that morning too. So I got two of the things that were missing. within 2 days because he just showed me that. I'm like, yeah, you're right. I asked him what you just said, the purpose, like what was the purpose of that? And he said, I feel him saying that we're never far away to help guide you with anything. Whether in his opinion, he's like as silly as a ring to a move, to a job or a career or a client. But the best way to receive information is through prayer or meditation, whatever you modality you choose.
Prayer and meditation. So is he saying, because of course people tuning in, always we're always losing stuff or missing stuff or can't find stuff. My question is, I mean, is that just something that we have to pay attention to? And is he saying go into an inner voice mode to find out where this stuff is? Because we kind of subconsciously know where it is? Or is he saying, you know, is this a way of accessing people on the other side, which is, you know, to open ourselves up to the pot? Oh, okay, you tapped your nose. Yeah. So we open ourselves up to the.
I only do that during this podcast. With
I've never seen you do it anywhere else. But it's shorthand for like, yes, we get that. All right, that's very good. Jim, I appreciate it. Happy New Year to you. And of course, we always appreciate when you stop by. I'm quoting you all the time because people talk to me about, you know, what he said to us about grief. If you can try to move grief to nostalgia, you can begin the healing process. It's such a powerful thing.
He just said, he goes, he loves that I'm working with Heather. So Tony, my assistant Tony, she's still part of our team, my team, but she's handling just the cases. And Heather, my sister, is actually my executive assistant, which I love.
Oh, fabulous, Heather. Welcome to Jennifer World.
Welcome to my crazy world. She's like, I don't know how you do it. I look at all, like, oh, she goes, it gives me anxiety looking at your schedule. I'm like, I know. I woke up early this morning with the sunrise and I just have had to start doing that in order to get my, you know, in order to get fit in a workout or whatever.
Motor going. Yeah, of course. Well, that's great, Heather. We appreciate that. You know, helping out your sister. I mean, who gets to do that? That is just so cool. Well, speaking of sisters, we have our friend Luana Anders on the flip side who moderates our class over on the other side of the veil, so to speak. Jennifer was holding up her name written down, meaning, you know, Jennifer and I never discussed what we're going to talk about beforehand.
And yeah, you didn't know about my ring. I never told you.
No. And
it was probably why I was drinking during our episode, even though it was New Year's Day.
You know, you did. You did that very well. I know how much that ring means to you. You hit that very well. Well, Luana, is there somebody on your VIP?
One other thing he just told me, he's like, you can't take it with you. Stop it. You can't take it with you. And he's just like, you know, just remember that. It's just,
you know, it popped into my head today because when my parents passed away, there were some, you know, artifacts, the French Legion of Honor my grandfather had earned. And I was reading about it today, how Napoleon had created that. And anyway, and I was thinking about like how it was stolen from our house. And I really wanted to look it over. And I asked my father to help me find it. And I heard his voice in my head say, it is where it's supposed to be. Meaning you don't have to go look for things. If it's in your heart, it's in your heart. You know, it's a thing. It's a prop.
Things.
You know, they're not attached to it, but we are. So, right. I mean, I know that not that many people have a French Legion of Honor, and it wasn't for me, but it was for my grandfather. So
that is really, really cool. Let's hope it's in a museum. Maybe they caught whoever stole it. Now it's in a
pawn shop somewhere, I'm sure, in Chicago. Anyway, Luana, the spotlight is on you, my dear. What would you like to bring forward to talk to us about today? Or who?
Things. That's so funny. Okay. Oh. She's like, let's segue into your next book.
Okay. Let's segue.
And into your meditations too. I want to explain something too. And this is something we haven't discussed. I did post it, even though I can't comment on it. I can post it on my page. We still haven't figured this out.
Yeah, I don't know why that is.
You're offering meditations now. Somebody can book online a meditation with you, correct?
Yes, that's correct. A guided meditation, meaning, as opposed to me just talking about how to float, downstream, the idea is to show and demonstrate how you can use a guided meditation to talk to your guides, your teachers, sometimes your council members, and sometimes people off stage who still want to hang out with you and will show up.
Remember what you did when I called you, and I was just devastated over my dad. And I was actually talking about his eulogy and how what I was going to write and what, and I was working with, I asked for your guidance. And you're like, let's just go through, let's ask Jim, let's go through. I'll never forget it because I was in my car and you're like, let's just go, just don't crash. Let's just go through a meditation. And you took me to the waterfalls. It was so powerful and helped me so much with my grief. That for anybody that's going through grief, even that kind of meditation that
I
you
didn't
walk
think of
me
that. You're
through,
right. That's a vase meditation. It's a different way of dealing with
it's a different way, but I needed that so much. And it just for what you did for me, if it made that kind of impact, I can't imagine what you could do for other people.
Well, I think it's a great, thank you for sharing that. I think it's a good point, which is if somebody, maybe somebody doesn't want to talk to the council, maybe they just want to get over something. And for whatever reason, I have traveled around the planet. I've been to Tibet with Robert Thurman. I've heard him give these meditations, but for some reason, I don't forget them. They sort of soak in there and then I hold on to them and I remember them. And so it's like I'm passing along something that I've heard or experienced, or like Jennifer said, I don't remember doing that with you, but I know how the meditation goes and I
Yeah.
know how it can be helpful to people.
I was on San at the corner of San Vicente and Wilshire when we started it. Heading back, I was coming from an appointment. Yeah. I'll never forget it. It's one of those imprints because it had an emotion attached to it. So I'm not going to forget it. Just like I don't remember what I say in readings necessarily. I'm such a Magoo, it you channel it. And so you channeled it, and that's why you don't remember.
Very good. All right. Well, Lou, I want to get back to your comment about the next project.
Yes,
So
please.
I've been editing it, trying to finish it, and I'm almost, and I'm kind of, I talked to my whatever, my manager, agent, we're going to call him that. And, he was like, oh, this is great. This sounds really good. But it'll take a long time, if we go through the process to see if anybody wants to publish it, da 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 da. It won't be out for a long time. And I was kind of thinking about, I really need to get this out there ASAP, because I'll be talking about the topic in, I don't know, whatever, May, June, conference in the desert, talking about people off planet.
Oh, wow.
Aliens, as we like to refer to them, but so it's
Aren't there
all,
a lot? That's interesting.
well, it's a whole book about people's reports, people that I've talked to, people that we've talked to, and sometimes when you're having a conversation with somebody about their council, they'll say, I'm seeing this really weird thing. There's a person on my council who's like an alien. And then instead of saying, okay, I say, all right, that's great. Can we talk to them? And then I ask them questions,
Right.
which the person I'm talking to has no conscious awareness that you can have a conversation with somebody. They don't know who this person is, but the person I'm referring to, it answers the questions. And sometimes they go, oh, yes, Richard, we know you. Of course.
Yeah.
Everybody's talking about your goofy work. Anyway, but Luana, is that what you wanted to talk about?
She said, as you would say, dive deeper. There's more. Well, you'll get a lot of information about the solar flares, like with what your wife,
Talked about, yeah, we mentioned that.
and oh, are you going to George Norrie about your Jesus book, or is there anything that you know about with the
Well,
whole?
let's ask her. What is she? I mean, I don't, they don't really deal with stuff like that on their show. That's why I haven't been on there in a while, because
They
they know.
do everything.
Well, they don't deal with him because it's a religious thing. That's the way they just don't do that. And that's fine. I understand that. But what do you want to say about the book, Luana? Is there some comment? The greatest story never told is told by Jesus and those who love him.
Jesus was an alien.
That's what she's saying, that Jesus was an alien. Okay, half of our audience just drove off the road.
I know.
Well, what are you saying, Lou?
Hold on.
Are you joking, or what are you trying to tell us? Or are we all aliens because we all choose to incarnate?
We're all aliens.
Okay, I understand. We've heard that. We heard that from Stephen Hawking, who, you know, during one of our conversations, I asked him if he'd met any aliens, and he went, everybody's an alien because we choose to incarnate as humans, you see? So it's a philosophical point. But Luana, what do you want to say? What do you want to say about either the Jesus book or this alien book? I mean, I don't know how to connect those two.
I don't know. She's saying you should be comparing notes with those two. Like things that you hear over and over again, I guess.
Comparing notes. Okay.
Maybe it's just, hold on. It almost feels like there's something like Jesus on every planet, or there's something like with that energy everywhere. So maybe there might be some ties to.
You mean like a universal benevolence or unconditional love, and maybe an avatar comes along that represents that sort of energy. Yes. Is that something like that? Okay. Because we have heard that in our, you know, we've heard people like so-and-so, you know, like a particular avatar, fill in the blank, Krishna, you know, other people that we've talked to that are off planet, you know, that don't come from this planet. We heard that about the people that are like Ma Durga, for example. Now, this ties it all together because when we were talking to your father, so, you know, one of our first conversations, I asked him, are you taking any classes? And he took you to classroom that he was taking in astrophysics. And it was like, ironically, it was like in deep, deep space to get there. And as we arrived, he said, don't be worried about the way the teacher looks. You're going to be a little bit confused by that. And you saw a woman wearing a cape, but also you could see that she had eight arms.
She was wearing like this green cape, actually. It kind of feels very familiar.
Well, I'll tell you what, let's tie it all together. So, Jim, can you take us into your classroom with Ma Durga?
You said, sure. They're like grabbing my hand and jumping in a timeline. It's so weird, but not.
Give us a visual. What does that look like?
Visual is he grabbed my hand and we're just literally jumping into a timeline, like into a period where she's at.
Oh, okay. And are you going? Oh, you're going to where when he was in the class?
Or I don't know. I think so.
Okay. Yeah, because I think he mentioned about graduating and on to other classes, but still. So, okay. And maybe talk to Ma Durga. Now, for the audience, this is a teacher. Let's start with that. She's a teacher of an astrophysics class.
Yes, and she doesn't talk like this. She just projects her feelings and thoughts, but that's what she's showing me. Yes.
Very good. And so, and for the audience to understand what we're doing, this is a teacher who teaches a class on the flip side. So, if I may call you Ma, how did you arrive to this occupation of being a teacher in this classroom?
By being very old.
You mean the older, the more gray hair you have, the more teaching assignments you get?
Hold on. She says she's an intelligence, or not she, but yeah, Ma, we'll call her, is an intelligence that spans through all space and time.
And so are you talking about the frequency of your intelligence or the physical aspect of your intelligence, of your wisdom, of your conscious energy?
All of it, yes.
All of it. And so just in terms of, just for the audience to understand, because we've spoken to you before, you were teaching a class in astrophysics. I mean, that's a stage term that we use to understand or comprehend. But please describe a little bit what the curriculum is. What kind of things do you talk about or teach in that class?
How the laws are different in different energies.
The laws of. Go ahead.
The laws of frequencies. Like she's showing us how slow we are here, you know, and then she sped us up really fast. She's showing me talking really fast. Like there's different laws with different places that people live. So when you live outside of space and time, the laws outside of space and time do pertain to here, but not directly.
And if I may, and correct me if I'm wrong, what you're talking about, like in the movie Interstellar, when you go onto a certain planet, she tapped her nose, that's correct. The time is completely different. The time frame, it's completely different. And we've heard this from people on the flip side that they operate at a different frequency than us, which is, let's say, exponentially faster, and they have to slow themselves down to talk to us. So in your class, though, you're outside of time. Is that correct?
She's using us as an example, me being here and her over there. So how we're sharing space right now, which is going through my brain and hers, like my, so just give me a second. It's very interesting. My dad's just laughing. I'm trying to understand it, Dad. This is so fun, by the way, just seeing him, because it's usually the only time I believe he's here is why when we talk.
We talk to him. Yeah, it's great.
Trust. Hold on. It's almost like the vibration keeps bouncing off things and comes back. So, like
a reflection.
Yeah, interesting. To a certain degree, we're the stars that are shining here that take a long time to get over that. Like, it's a weird.
Okay. Let's allow that, because we're lights. All of us are lights. And so the light of who we are now versus, our conversation with her over there. Let me ask you this, Ma. We've seen, Jennifer's seen you with eight arms.
My higher self talking to him. Yes. Okay. That's
how. Is Jennifer's higher self talking to them? Is that right? Okay. And so we've seen you with eight arms. Is that the right number of arms? And if so, why? Why eight?
She just showed me an octopus. Is that the same?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Very good. Are you, let me ask you, have you ever incarnated on our planet as an octopus?
She's like, yeah, she was an octopus, and that's why she kept her eight arms, because she could do more.
Oh, brilliant. Okay, I've never asked the question before. I was going to ask you, do you appear the same way as people do with eight arms on other planets, let's say? Or is this because you actually had a lifetime here on this planet? Is that correct?
Yes.
So we actually, go ahead.
She was in physical form first. And then, and I've never seen this before, just let me, I'm hoping I'm getting the right interpretation.
Please,
just
go ahead.
Through mystical stories, she was, okay.
Go ahead, say that again.
Through mysticism. So I feel like she was a young girl. Like, she came here. She's saying that she was in human form first. And then there was something about, not, I don't know, I can't quite understand the whole octopus thing, but it has to do with what she was viewed at later, with the eight arms. They made her into a goddess, correct?
That's correct. The Hindu religion considers her one of
okay.
wise wisdom makers.
Right. And the octopus represents that for the sea.
And it's interesting, I'm sure you don't remember, but our last podcast, Michael Newton, the hypnotherapist, came through and was talking about how people from other planets incarnate here as animals of the sea, as people on Earth. And it was a fascinating conversation. So she's confirming that in an unusual way, that in her energy, her conscious energy, she chose that form and now continues to maintain it. But is there a value to having eight arms other than that's just kind of cool? And I mean, there's eight brains in an octopus. I don't know if that's related.
She says she's a chameleon. She changes all the time.
I see. So, and do you maintain this one image so people recognize you? Is that it?
Yes.
Okay, very good.
Energy is recognized. So when, some people recognize her as that little girl. It just depends on where you are in
the timeline. So let me ask you, what's your opinion of what we're doing?
It's challenging to be you.
You mean to be human or to be Richard?
To be To be human, Richard.
To be human. All right. It's...
But especially me. She's like, you're the one trying, you're the one interpreting everything. Hold on. But she loves that I love it. I love what I do for work. I hope I always love what I do for work. It's always fascinating to me. She's showing me like past, present, future, all this is all together is doing well. Like the earth, like everything. She says that it's, show me one more time. As humans, we are doing well.
So we're on the right path. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly where we're supposed to be.
Exactly where we're supposed to be. And so I'm asking also your opinion of what Jennifer and I are doing, talking to you off planet, someone who people would consider an alien or would consider a teacher or would consider a goddess.
She's like, you're pretty much the only ones that do. She goes, people talk to us, but you're pretty much the only ones that can believe we can talk back.
Who ask questions and try to contemplate the answers. I mean, it's a very... That's fascinating because we had met you before and I had asked and I had then researched eight-armed deity because you had said that people on Earth knew who you were and I found your name, et cetera, et cetera. So, and my friends in India are now right now pulling their hair out going, what is he talking about? So Ma Durga, please give us some advice of how to navigate our planet in the coming year because we're going to have a lot of stress here. So can you give us some advice on that?
Calm your heart rates down. She's showing me like how my dad couldn't talk to me or get into my head because I was so frazzled. You're like that all the time. You're not able to get anything from the universe. She's like, it's bountiful there. People still feel like they're lacking, but it's bountiful. And
you mean on Earth?
On Earth. She says, you just should be taking care of one another better.
Does meditation help with that? Would that be a mode of helping people?
Thousands of years, yes.
Thousands of years. All right, very good. And so, Jennifer, describe what you're seeing. So, because people don't understand what we're talking about. What are you seeing? Are you seeing her? I mean, what does she look like? Whatever you're seeing.
I'm feeling her next to me. My dad is right there. And my dad just went for, it almost felt like he went for a run. So they're showing me things, reflections of things that we've discussed that are pictures. And so, you know, one of my dreams that my dad came into, he was running. My dad was a runner. He was a marathon runner. And so he showed me, like, where are you running? He goes, space. We can run. We can do. Okay. Anyway, that was just shown to me, but it comes
in beautiful, beautiful.
And feelings. And, he was just saying, cause I worked out for the first time all year and no, I played pickleball yesterday, but anyway, he was just telling me that's good to keep my body strong. That's why he showed me a picture of him running. Okay. Hold on. It's more of a presence just because I can see things, people get kind of, they think that they can't feel, like they feel
caught up in the visual.
Caught up in the visual. Don't get caught up in the visual. It's get caught up in the feelings that you feel, the association, like the feelings. They'll show you pictures.
Yeah.
You know, they'll even give you questions to ask them if you're quiet long enough. And they just show me like how you have talked about asking a question. If you get the answer before the question's even finished, you know that's coming from them. And that's helped so many people, Richard, just that alone. With what you've said.
Yeah, it's that idea that you have a question, but before you can even ask it, there's the answer as a visual or a sound or a music.
So that happened with my bracelet. I was barely going into it and I got that picture dumped into my head and I went, oh, I went to this drawer and I put something, the reason why I put something away in this drawer and it happened to fall in there with it.
Ah, okay.
But I, for the life of me, had no idea where it was. But before I even finished that thought, they already put a picture in my head. So it does come sometimes in pictures and feelings.
Well, let's ask Luana because we have her. Luana, what's your impression of what we're doing? Talking to Ma Durga, talking to Jim. And is this tied together with why you wanted to have this conversation?
Giving people permission to do the same.
Giving people permission to do the same, to talk to your loved ones that are off planet, to ask questions, to ask them how they're doing.
Talk to your guides. And there's another thing they brought up earlier. There's nothing that you've done so bad that they're not going to be there for you. People get caught up in guilt. They're not, if you think they're not showing up for you, that's just because you feel guilty about something, or you feel like there's something that's unrest, or you're still mourning somebody. Give yourself time with that. But guilt is like the number one thing, whether you feel guilty about your life. They don't care. They want you. They don't stop coming to help you because you feel bad about yourself. They're always there for us. They think it's silly. Our higher selves are like, oh, look at her. She went and got a divorce. Oh, poor baby. Remember, there's no the timing over there. There's like nothing with time over there.
Well, it is a funny observation when you put yourself in the shoes of somebody off stage and they look at the stage performance, then people up there are saying, I'm never going to incarnate again. I really hate it here, blah, blah, blah. And off stage are going, oh, how many times have we heard that comment?
Heard that, yet I, every time I see, like, if anybody wants to come here, it is so packed with spirits. They so want to be here to feel. I've heard that they will come here and just feel pain just to feel it.
Just to incarnate. Oh, so many people want to be on the planet. It's like, if you don't want to be on the planet, great. I got 500 people that are waiting to jump in to have this experience. That's great. You go sit on the bench. We got plenty of time. Very good. Luana, is there anything else you want to bring to us? I know we got to go. One last word from Lou. Or Ma Durga.
Love is the quickest way to get answers.
That's about as deep as we can get for today.
Loving yourself, loving others, loving where you are in life, trying to find just one thing that you're grateful for.
Okay, look at that. Lou calling me from the flipside. All right, thank you, Jennifer. Thank you so much. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Ma Durga. How unusual to come forward like that. And Jennifer, thank you for your gifts, and have a lovely rest of your day, and we'll catch you on the flip side.
Bye.
Love.
This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jennifershaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Amazon Prime.